in this video segment, I'm going to go ahead and talk about a second tool that the government can use to change the level of aggregate demand, and that's the idea of fiscal policy. So monetary policy, just to make sure we're clear, monetary policy is about changes in the money supply. And that is executed by the Federal Reserve or other central bank. Fiscal policy is about changes in government taxes, we often call T, or government spending, which in our GDP accounting equation is G. And these are executed through the government's tax and budgeting process, which is, of course, decided by Congress and the president at the national level and state legislatures and governors at the state level. So, how does fiscal policy work? If we want to have what's called an expansionary fiscal policy, an expansionary fiscal policy has as its object the goal of increasing aggregate demand. And remember that aggregate demand equals GDP, which equals consumption plus investment spending plus government spending plus exports minus imports. So if we want to increase aggregate demand, we can increase government spending. So tool number one, increase government spending. Or if we cut taxes, then we will probably increase people's consumption spending, and maybe depending on what type of taxes we cut, maybe we will increase investment spending as well. So notice this one is kind of indirect here. And you can see that the impact on GDP is, you know, relatively straightforward, much simpler than it was in the case of monetary policy. Contractionary fiscal policy would have as its objective a decrease in aggregate demand. And that may sort of sound, you know, silly, but remember that a decrease in aggregate demand is going to cause a fall in the price level. So if we have an inflation problem, we would probably want to use contractionary fiscal policy. If we have an unemployment problem, then we want to use an expansionary fiscal policy. So notice, with both types of fiscal and monetary policy, we have a beneficial effect on either employment or inflation, but not on both at the same time. So while aggregate demand has an increase in aggregate demand has the advantage of increasing GDP and decreasing unemployment, it also has the disadvantage of increasing inflation. So, with our contractionary fiscal policy, what are our tools? Well, basically, it's the opposite of what we did with expansionary fiscal policy. We can either decrease the level of aggregate demand by cutting the level of government spending in the economy, or we can do it by increasing taxes, which is going to affect GDP by causing people to cut their consumption spending or possibly cut their investment spending. Often the government is sort of doing multiple things with taxes and spending all at the same time. So another way of looking at this is, if we want to increase aggregate demand, we want to increase the size of our budget deficit, because that either means that taxes fell by more than government spending fell, in which case it's more expansionary than contractionary, or government spending rose by more than taxes rose. So an increase in the size of the budget deficit is expansionary fiscal policy. If we want to have contractionary fiscal policy, then we're going to be looking at a situation where the budget deficit is going down. So this sort of makes budget deficits look pretty appealing. But one thing we have to remember out there is we have to think about something like the loanable funds model. And we have to remember that a change in the government's budget deficit impacts the level of national saving. So to say that the budget deficit goes up is equivalent to saying that national saving is going down. And if national saving is going down, that's going to cause long-run real interest rates to go up. And if real interest rates are going up, that's going to tend to depress investment spending. A little bit less obviously, if real interest rates are up higher, then U.S. assets look more appealing to foreign investors, and foreign investors are going to want to buy dollars so that they can invest in the U.S. So we're going to have a stronger dollar, and a stronger dollar is going to mean lower exports and higher imports. So these potentially might offset some of the stimulus that we had up there. It would also potentially would impact long-run economic growth. And that's sort of the reason why economists say that we do need to worry about budget deficits somewhat because of this impact on long-run economic growth. If we have a contractionary fiscal policy, then we're having an increase in national saving. And interest rates are going to fall. And if interest rates fall, then we're going to have a weaker dollar. And a weaker dollar is going to mean higher exports and lower imports. Also, the decrease in interest rates and increase in national saving are going to mean that we're going to have higher investment spending. And overall, sort of if you look at the impact of budget deficits boost aggregate demand in the short run. So they increase short-run economic growth, but they decrease long-run economic growth. Cutting back on the deficit, making the budget deficit fall, causes aggregate demand to fall, so it causes short-run economic growth to be lower, but it causes long-run economic growth to be higher. So really, sort of what is an appropriate action on the budget deficit really depends upon the circumstances at any given time. If your bigger problem that you're worried about right now is short-run economic growth, then a higher budget deficit looks appealing. If you're more worried about long-run economic growth than short-run economic growth, then a smaller budget deficit looks appealing.